Thank you very much, everyone, for coming out. Adam Bass, I'm one of the medical oncologists here at Dana-Farber, but I really spend most of my time running a lab working on the cancer genome and working to develop new therapies. So I want to tell a little bit about what we're doing, not just our own lab, but more in a bigger picture for how we're trying to use the laboratory and use science to bring forward new and better therapies. So in the past, really for the last, you know, be it 30, 40, 50 years, the cornerstone of thinking about cancer therapy from the perspective of a medical oncologist was that of old-fashioned chemotherapy, where we were essentially sort of by trial and error mixing and matching different chemicals to try to find combinations that worked a little bit better than other combinations. I think increasingly what we're doing now is moving from this trial and error approach to really a new approach where we try to understand what drives, what makes each cancer tick, and then to go after that particular cause of the cancer, a much more rational or targeted way of thinking about cancer therapy. And just like if your car was broken, you would look under the hood to see what was going on. In cancer, we want to be able to look under the hood of the cancer to see what is making the cancer cell wrong, what's making the cancer cell go. And the key way we do that is this idea of looking at the genome or the DNA. And DNA is in each of the cells of our body. It's a long string of letters, A, G, C's, and T's, that make genes that are really the recipe book for everything that the cell does. And just like any recipe, there are a number of different ingredients. And one way to think about cancer and think about cancer genes is by analogy again to a car, where just like a car has parts that make it go and a car has parts that make it stop, a cell has those parts too. And the genes, there are some genes that make the car's gas pedal and there are some genes that make the car's brakes. And one way to think about how cancer forms is that some of the genes that are responsible for the brakes don't work, and so the car might lose its brakes and not be able to stop. And some of the genes that would make the car's gas pedal become hyperactive. And so if you could imagine a car where the gas pedal was hyperactive and the brakes were cut, that car would go too fast and keep on going and not be able to slow down. In a similar way, the genes in some of the cells of the body get altered and so lose the ability to slow down and have too much ability to go forward. And that's, in a way, what happens with cancer. And I want to just quickly talk about a couple of things just for clarity, because when we talk about cancer genes, people can often get a little bit mixed up, rightly so, about what kind of genes we're talking about, because there are the genes that we pass on to our kids, and they're the genes that we have that we often talk about in cancer. So we often talk about this as the somatic genes and germline or inherited genes. So just to be clear, most of what we are dealing with when we talk about cancer genes and cancer-targeted therapy are what we call somatic changes. This means these are how the cells of the genes in a cancer cell are different from the genes in the rest of the body because they have changes or mutations. Now, so most of the cancer genes are these kinds of genes, and most of the genes we're thinking about targeting with our therapy are these kinds of alterations. This is how this cancer cell is different from the rest of the body. And that's important because that means those particular gene changes in the cancer are not the gene changes that people are going to pass on to their children, because these are only in the cancer cells, they're not in the rest of the body. By contrast, there are other gene changes that are what we call the germline alterations. This is what you inherit from your mom and your dad. And so these, unlike the cancer genes at first, I'm talking about at the top, these are in all the cells of your body. These are the things you do pass on to your children, such as the BRCA1, which is a risk factor gene for breast cancer. Most GI cancers, we think, are not caused by these. So generally, when we talk about gene testing, you know, personalized medicine, we're really not talking about things that have a impact upon people's children. These are really upon the things that are really how the cancer is different than the rest of the body. And so with that aside, so why is it that looking at the genome is going to help us treat patients? So tumors become dependent upon these active genes that are making the cancer go. Just like you have, if the car is going fast because the gas pedal is, you know, caught to the floor, you know, taking away the gas pedal will make the car slow down. So the genes that make cancer go are important to the cancer. And so we have drugs that could effectively block these activated genes, and these are highly effective. But as Charlie Fuchs mentioned, you could have two people walking into clinic that had quote-unquote the same cancer because they look the same under the microscope, but they might have two different genes that are making the cancer grow. So therefore, these two people who have what we would initially say are the same cancer might actually be optimally treated by different therapies, and the gene testing could help us know which therapy may be better. So the big idea is that by profiling the genome, the DNA changes of each patient's cancer, we could get ideas of what's making the cancer tick, what's making the cancer grow, and that could really help us to select what we think will be optimal therapies for each tumor. So, and one other kind of aside I wanted to put in here, and this I put in last night while I was looking at my slides, so it's not in the handout, is that targeted therapy is not gene therapy. So we're talking a lot about therapies attacking genes, but really genes are the recipes for proteins. So when you say we have the KRAS gene is the recipe to make the KRAS protein. And proteins do work in the cell, and so mutant genes make mutant proteins. Abnormal genes make abnormal proteins. And so drugs block proteins. So when we're doing our targeted therapies, we're trying to attack the abnormal proteins. We're not really treating the genes, we're not changing the genes, but the gene information gives us an idea of which protein we're going to try to target. So we're not doing gene therapy when we do targeted therapy. But genomic profiling could help us put patients into meaningful groups that could help us to define how to do better therapy. You could have a group of patients who you think are the same until you look at the genes and you realize you have two distinct groups of people. And much of what lets us do this work is incredible advances in technology. And we all know how fast technology has moved. You know, if you look at the comparison of the computer I had when I was a freshman in college to the computer I carry around in my pocket now, I mean, it's amazing how fast that has improved in, I guess, more years than I'd like to think. But our ability to look at the cancer genome has blown that out of the water. So the CEO or the president of the company Intel that makes computer chips had this rule of thumb called Moore's Law that computers will get twice as fast every 18 months. And so this white line shows how quickly our ability to look at the cancer DNA would improve over time if they improved as quickly as our ability to make better computers. But the orange line shows how fast we've been able to make improvements in our ability to look at DNA. And the key point is that looking at, for example, at sequencing the whole DNA of a person, which is something that 10 or 15 years ago would have cost hundreds of millions of dollars and people across the world spending years of work to do it, now that is something that is thousands of dollars in days or weeks of work. So this amazing change in technology has allowed us to do things now that would have been impractical or essentially science fiction not too many years ago. And that includes really the ability to really deeply ask what are the changes in cancer samples, to look in thousands, hundreds of samples very carefully to say what are the gene changes that make cancers tick. And in summary, cancer is a disease of the genome. There are altered genes. This is a picture of the chromosomes from a cancer. You should have one of each from your, one from mom, one from dad, but you see all these, you know, funny numbers here where you have four of this chromosome, three of that chromosome. Pieces are, you know, put together in funny ways. Is there abnormal genes make cancer? And increasingly, we have drugs that attack abnormal genes in cancer, and then increasingly, we could use gene tests to make that difference, and our ability to look at the genome is incredible. So, and we, as Charlie mentioned, are leading huge efforts to do this across a number of cancers. And this is a picture of our work in gastric cancer, how we were able to find four different rational groups of gastric cancer from our work of the cancer genome. But now, how do we take this forward? So the first thing we're doing is we have a big effort called Profile to how to bring the genome into patient care. So for now, patients in the clinic here are being consented to get genome testing on their tumor. And then for patients who consent, we're able to obtain a sample of the tumor from surgery or from a biopsy and extract the genes and characterize them in the lab to see what are the key changes in those in the DNA of each patient. And increasingly, our goal is to use that information to guide our therapy. Now, I think this is exciting and important, but I think we have to think about how we're going to go beyond this, how we're going to make it better. Because you could easily take the first part of what I've told you and say, well, treating cancer should be really easy. You're going to take three people, and you'll say, you know, Mrs. Smith has a gene X alteration, Mrs. Jones has a gene Y alteration, and Mr. Jones has a gene Z alteration, so it's easy. We'll just give them anti-X, anti-Y, and anti-Z, and everything will be all better. You know, I wish that was the case. So really, we have to think about how we're going to make it better, and I think this quote from Wayne Gretzky sort of is that kind of idea. You know, we have to not think about where the puck is now, but think where the puck is going. And so where the puck is now has been thinking about how do we get the right drug to the right person, where the puck is going to think how to make this even better. And so and I say that we have to do even better because we know that cancer is a tough enemy. And even these therapies we're trying to develop now, by looking at the genes and trying to find the right drug for the right patients, they're a huge step forward, but by themselves they're not going to be enough. We have more to do. Because we can give the right drug to the right patient, and we think we're doing this to the cancer. We think we're closing off their road for them, keeping them from moving forward, but cancers are smart. So if they see that roadblock, this is what they're going to see. If you block Newbury Street in Boston, the cars are going to go down Boylston Street. So if you block one road for cancer, the cancer's going to find a way to work around that. So genome-guided therapy is a huge step forward, but it's not a panacea. It's not going to be simple. Cancers are smart. Good targeted therapies can be very effective, but they're generally temporarily effective. Because tumors are smart, they learn to become resistant. Sometimes they become resistant quickly. Sometimes it takes them months or years to become resistant. So we have to learn how tumors become resistant. How are they going to try to get around our therapies? So how we can block their escape. And essentially, we need to do this in the laboratory so when we bring drugs into patients, we know how the tumors are going to try to work around them and how we can be ready to have the next therapy to be even better. So what I think building from the right drug for the right patient is really then figuring out how cancers are going to try to escape our therapy and how do we block their ability to do so to make our therapies even better. And I think the analogy for where this is moving is in some ways you can imagine this is a game of chess against cancer. Because you're going to put something in cancer's way, and then you know, okay, cancer is not going to wave the white flag. They're going to cancer is tough. So cancer is going to try to work around it. So you have to think, if I do this, what's the cancer going to do next? Just like when you play chess, you say, if I move my piece here, they're going to move there, and I have to be ready for that. So we have to think, what's cancer going to do next? How are we going to be ready to block it when it makes its next move? And so to do that, we really have to do work in the laboratory to figure out how do cancers try to evade our therapies? How do we can try to make our therapies better? So how do we bring patients, how do we bring cancers into the laboratory so we could try to figure this out? Basically, we need to study real cancer in the laboratory. And we need our what we call models. We can't test everything that we want to test in patients. First, it's not ethical, it's not practical, so we want to bring things into models, into things that look and feel and are like cancer in the lab that we could work on. So how can we do this? Also, we need to have lots of models of cancer. We don't want to just have one model of colon cancer, one model of pancreatic cancer. You know, just like we would never do a clinical trial in one patient and say, okay, we tried this therapy in one patient and it works, we're going to give it for everyone with colon cancer. We wouldn't want to have one laboratory model of colon cancer and assume that whatever works in that one tumor is going to work in everybody. We need to have lots of different models. And so we need to have models where we know what genes are altered. So just like the patients who come into clinic have tumors with different gene changes, we need models with all of that different variation as well, so we can have the models that are similar to the patients we have in clinic. So what are we doing? So increasing efforts we have are to use our patients or to learn from our patients and to build these models. So when people are getting cancer samples taken for part of their care because they're having surgery, they're having a biopsy, they're having an endoscopy, they're having fluid taken off, we can get some of that tissue and we could do a few things. One is we could profile it to see what are the genes that are altered, but also we could take that and grow it in the lab in different ways. One way is what we see here is we actually can take a little piece of a tumor and implant it into a special kind of mouse in the mouse's back, and the tumor can grow in the mouse. And then if you have tumor growing in one mouse, it gets bigger, then you put it in 3 mice, it gets bigger, then you put it in 9 mice, it gets bigger, then you put it in 20 mice. Well, all of a sudden you have one patient's tumor in 20 mice. And so then you could do is you could do a clinical trial in that one patient's tumor. You could say, I'm gonna give these 5 mice drug A, I'm going to give these 5 mice drug B, 5 mice drug C, and 5 mice drug D, and we're going to see what happens. And also, because there's mice, you can do things you can't do in people. So, you know, you could give the drug, and then, you know, 5 days later, you could harvest the tumor and say, okay, what's the tumor doing now? We gave this drug, how is the tumor working around our therapy? You could do things to learn how to play the game of chess and cancer with these mice and do things you can't do in people. And so we could do this increasingly building this sort of repository of models of cancer to allow us to sort of investigate our therapies becomes increasingly critical to our work. And we could also think about learning from patients in different ways, because you know, as patients go through therapy, we're going to have opportunities to expand our research. So you could have a person who goes on a therapy, they're going to get a particular drug, an inhibitor of drug X, and then, you know, maybe their tumor gets smaller, but then a year later, the tumor gets bigger. So at all those different times, there are chances for us to learn something. You know, so for example, we can now perform research biopsies where you could say, okay, you have a tumor baseline, then you gave it drug X. We could get a biopsy then say, okay, what does the tumor do now? You gave it drug X. How is it trying to work around our therapies? Or maybe a year later, the tumor has learned a new trick to evade our therapies. Let's get a sample now and let's figure out what's the tumor doing now that it wasn't doing a year ago? Why is the drug not working anymore? And how can we use this information to make our therapies even better the next time? So I think the cancer genome is increasingly going to help us guide therapy. Increasingly, we're going to start with figuring out what the genes are, what are the key genes, and then go from that to saying, what are the therapeutic vulnerabilities from cancer? And then we're going to take that information and we're going to use the diagnostics to try to develop better therapies. But that's the first part. And then as we do this, we're going to try to understand resistance, understand how to make our therapies better, how to develop rational combinations, how to combat resistance. I think this is where we're going with our efforts in the cancer genome and our efforts to build models and do research biopsies. But this is, it's a lot of work. It requires a lot of people, it requires a lot of mice, it requires resources. And so just as, you know, as Charlie mentioned, you know, it's unfortunate that we're trying to do this in an era that the resources, financial resources for science have been dwindling. But we're going to, you know, continue to push ahead and do everything that we can. The other thing I wanted to mention quickly in this talk, because I'm sure it's a question that everyone has these days, are also some new areas in GI cancer research. And probably the one area I just wanted to also touch on, because so many people are excited by this now, are the new therapies that are emerging to use the immune system to target cancer. So just last year, Science magazine called Cancer Immunotherapy their breakthrough of the year. And I'm sure from many of you from reading and talking to people are very excited about where immune therapies are moving. So what is cancer immunotherapy? So essentially, cancer's immunotherapy is using the patient's own immune system to fight cancer. Just like when we have a virus or a bacteria in our body and the body fights that off, can the body's immune system fight off cancer? So there are a few flavors of this. One is, I think, of sort of non-specific immunotherapies. There are drugs that basically can more generally augment the immune system. And the agents, the drugs that are already FDA approved, such as Keytruda, for example, or ipilimumab, or what we call checkpoint inhibitors, are these categories of more general immunotherapies that sort of broadly activate the immune system. The other are what we call cancer vaccines, which are really trying to get a specific immune response against a particular target. So this is just a sciencey slide here about checkpoint inhibitors. Essentially, our immune cells have things in our bodies that help them turn them on and help things that turn them off. And the things that turn off our immune system often get hijacked by cancers to help the cancers evade the immune system. And so we have drugs now that are trying to attack the off switches of the immune system, such as drugs such as Keytruda or ipilimumab. They're trying to inhibit targets such as PD-1 or CTLA-4. These are things that turn off the immune system. So there is work going on, an increasing amount of work now at Dana-Farber within and without, and both in the GI program and more broadly, to develop immunotherapies, because these are such exciting, promising new therapies across cancer. So there are several major efforts going on now. First, we are working very hard to develop a number of new clinical trials of some of the new immune agents that are coming, that are emerging from the pharmaceutical industry. We're also trying to figure out what are the right targets for immunotherapy in cancer. And here are there's a lot of shifting in our thinking, because some of what I was talking about earlier was really how we are using the DNA, the genome, to guide our therapy. And so now within the immunotherapy world, we're really trying to learn new rules for how to figure out what are the markers to tell which patient is going to benefit from which drug. And I think there's a lot of markers outside of cancer DNA that are going to be increasingly important for looking at immune therapies, and we're still trying to learn what those are. What are the right targets for GI cancers, and what are the markers to say which drugs may be efficacious for certain patients? And also, we need to develop new model systems to test immunotherapies. For example, if we're testing a targeted therapy in cancer, you could have cells growing in a plastic dish, and you can test something that blocks a particular protein in that cancer cell. But a plastic dish does not have an immune system. So if you want to test an immunotherapy, you can't do that in cells growing in a plastic dish. We have to develop a whole new host of models where we have cancer but also have a strong, intact immune system, so we can test emerging immunotherapies. So this is a huge investment in our lab, in particular right now, is investing heavily for esophageal and gastric cancer and building the new models that will allow us to test these therapies, because our old models won't do it. And so we're working right now within the program to develop a host of clinical trials. There are some trials, Dana-Farber, for these new immune therapies that are going to be open to patients without regard to what disease they have. They're going to be sort of, you know, early phase trials where whether you have colon cancer, lung cancer, breast cancer, you're still eligible. We're also working to develop some new trials that are going to be focused on particular diseases. And in some cases, the trials will be open to all, to more broadly, to all patients with a particular disease. In other cases, the tumor would have to be tested for a particular marker to say, okay, we're going to try to inhibit, you know, proteins that have expression of gene X. And so to be on the trial, you have to show that your tumor has gene X. So there are some trials where they'll be testing of a marker to see if you're eligible. And most of these trials, again, are the ones that are using these new drugs to broadly activate the immune system, i.e. not so much vaccine trials right now. So in summary of some of the things I've talked about, first on the first half of the talk, looking at the cancer genome and targeted therapy. So mutant genes genes that are different in the cancer than the rest of the body are the primary causes of cancer. These mutant genes can often tell us what are the best targets for each tumor, what are the best therapies to think of. We're working hard now to integrate this genome profiling into the clinic so we could get this data on our patients and also get it in ways that we could try to use it to inform therapies. In many cases, it'll be informing clinical trials, but still to inform how to treat our patients. And while this field is exciting, I don't want to make it sound too easy, and there's a lot of work to do in the laboratory to figure out the best strategies to make this work, because cancers are smart. Cancers will try to get around what we do to stop them, but we have to try to outsmart them and learn how they're going to try to work around our therapies, and we have to be ready to block their escape routes. Now also, there's immunotherapy. There's huge new advances in this field, and people are very excited, and they're excited for good reasons. These are extremely promising new therapies. We're still learning the rules for these new classes of therapies, especially for GI cancers. What are the right targets? What combinations? And just like we have to study resistance for other therapies, we're going to have to do that here too, because we'll have to figure out how the tumors work around these therapies. So who do we give them to and how? Those are key questions. And we have a bunch of new laboratory efforts and clinical trials to try to bring these therapies forward as well. So I want to thank you all for your time. I think we have a lot of exciting work going on across our program. We're really committed to making therapy of GI cancers better. And I know we can't do it fast enough, but thank you for your time.